Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever, forevermore. You are victorious. Take what I have known and break it all apart. For you, my God, are greater still. And no sky contains, no doubt restrains all you are. The greatness of our God. I'll spend my life to know. I'm far from close to all you are, the greatness of our God. Give
You know Bobby's not here, right? No. he's on a study break. And we're going to have fun. We're not going to, it's not just because Bobby's gone. Bobby's going to be listening to this. We love you, Bobby. On the count of three, can we say, we love you, Bobby? One, two, three. We love you, Bobby. We really mean it. And so the next several weeks, you're going to continue hearing from me. Don't let that demotivate you. And then you're going to hear some other people too. But we're going to have a really good summer. We're not going to take a vacation and like power down for the summer. We're going to rev up when it comes to following Jesus. Are you with me, church? All right, good. Ephesians chapter 5, beginning in verse 15. By the way, if you're a guest and you're here because of the ride, chances are we actually got to talk because I made it my goal to talk to all the guests. I am personally super grateful you chose to be here. You know who you are. We strive to be a welcoming, warm church. Guests, don't disappoint them. Extend a non-awkward greeting after we're done, okay? Ephesians chapter 5, beginning in verse 15. Here we go. These are the very words of God. Be careful then, very careful, how you live. Not as unwise, but as wise, making the most of every opportunity, because the days are evil. Therefore, don't be foolish, but understand what the Lord's will is. Don't get drunk on wine, which leads to debauchery. Instead, be filled with the Spirit, speaking to one another with psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs. Sing and make music from your heart to the Lord, always giving thanks to God the Father for everything. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, submit to one another out of reverence for Christ. Ephesians 5, 15 to 21, these are the very words of God. They were spoken, preserved, and passed down for nearly 2,000 years to teach us, so that through the endurance taught in the Scriptures and the encouragement they provide, we might have hope. Keep your Bible open. Keep the Bible app clicked open to those words. We're going to be walking through those words very intentionally. The Apostle Paul, the author, the writer, he opens this passage by introducing the topic of wisdom. That's a major theme in the Bible. There's actually an entire section of Scripture called wisdom literature. Wisdom's a big deal to God. And Jesus, of course, is the embodiment of wisdom. And if you're wondering, what is worldly wisdom versus godly wisdom or kingdom wisdom, as it might be referred to, I would encourage you to go to 1 Corinthians chapters 1 and 2. We won't do it now, but Paul lays out in those two chapters what the wisdom of God looks like when it's fully unveiled. You can go check it out. It's totally not what you expect. So when I talk to my children about wisdom, I talk about it like this. I try to break it down simply and say, intelligence is learning accurate information. It's knowing the right thing. Wisdom is learning what to do with the information you already have. It works like this. You leave church. On the way to lunch, you're on Mac Hatcher. Even though you saw the road sign that had a 55 on it, you decide to go 75. You get pulled over, and the officer approaches you and says, hey, my radar gun said that you were going 75. Did you know how fast you were driving? Did you know the speed limit? Yes, and yes. As a matter of fact, I did. And more than that, let's imagine you said this. I read the driver's, like the manual that's issued by the state, and I reread it all the time, and I even memorized this one portion. And then you recite some obscure piece of writing and content from the driver's manual, whatever they call it. And so you know the right thing, you saw the sign, and you've memorized a portion of the content. Now, what's the police officer going to say to you? I don't care. I don't care that you saw the sign or you read the book. I just like have proof of what you did. and there's a discrepancy between your knowledge and your behavior. Wisdom is not just acquiring knowledge and knowing the right thing. Wisdom calls for application. Knowing what to do with what you know and like applying the truth at the right time, in the right way, for the right reason. That is wisdom. And if you read this text carefully, you will see that wisdom is a gift of the Holy Spirit. Three characteristics of wise people come right out of the gate in this passage. If you had a bulletin that you walked in, you got it, turn it over to the back. This is your chance to take notes and fill in blanks. Three marks or characteristics of wise people. Number one, according to Ephesians 5, wise people make the most of their time. They make the most of their time. The verb make the most, it means to redeem or buy back. Time is a precious thing. It's also the great equalizer. We all have 60 minutes in an hour, 24 hours in a day. What you do with yours may not be what I do with mine, but we have access to the same allotted times. Wise people learn from their past. They plan for the future, and they seize opportunities in front of them in the present. In 1867, Swedish chemist Alfred Nobel invented a new high explosive called dynamite. He was convinced that his invention would make war too horrible to ever happen again. However, he quickly discovered that there was no shortage of buyers for his new explosive. He made a huge fortune. But he was horrified at the suffering and misery it caused in conflicts. So what did he do? Toward the end of the 19th century, he woke up one day, opened the newspaper, and was astonished to find out that in the obituary section that he was dead. Really, it said, Alfred Nobel, the inventor of dynamite, who died yesterday, devised a way for more people to be killed in a war than ever before. He died a very wealthy man. Actually, it was Alfred's brother who died. It was a misprint in the newspaper. But reading this and seeing his name in the obit section had a deep effect on him. And he decided right then and there that he wanted to be known for something other than developing a means to kill people efficiently and for being a war profiteer. So as a result, he personally funded and initiated the Nobel Prize, an award for scientists and writers who foster peace. Nobel said, and I quote, "Every man ought to have the chance to correct his epitaph in midstream and write a new one." What are you doing with your time? Number two, wise people pursue the will of God. Jesus teaches us to pray, "Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Your will be done in my marriage as it is in heaven. Your will be done in my career, with my children, with my home. Your will be done in the trial I'm in right now on earth as it is in heaven." Toward the end of his life, just hours before he was tortured and strung up on a cross, Jesus prayed a bold, courageous prayer. "Not my will, but yours be done." Nothing, nothing, nothing is more important in life than discovering and doing the will of God. And as you learn about God's will, it is vitally important that we learn to distinguish between God's general will for all believers and his particular will for specific followers of Jesus. General will is found in the Bible. If you want to know what does God want for all of his children, You can discover that for yourself in the Bible. The will of God for the people of God is revealed in the Word of God. But God's particular will for us in the situation you're walking through at this moment or in this circumstance is found by taking advantage of three means of discernment. Here they are. Number one, reading the Bible. You saw that one coming. And letting your mind be saturated and influenced and shaped by God's general will for all of His people. That's the first one. Number two is prayer. That's right. We typically think of prayer as talking, but in the Bible, prayer is mainly listening. It begins with the expectation that God has a voice. He does not have laryngitis, and He has something to say, and He is willing to speak if we give Him the room. I wonder if you listen to God and expect to hear something when you pray. And the third lever to turn when it's time to discern the will of God is seeking wise counsel from mature believers. That is why we have the church, communal discernment, having the Bible in your mind and having a heart of prayer and then going to people that you know are full of the Holy Spirit. They trust and follow Jesus. They're not getting it perfect, but the trajectory of their life is proven. The fruit is there. And you go and you say, here's what I'm dealing with. What do you think would please the Lord Jesus in this situation? And listen. That's why there's a church. That's why we have each other. I'm always shocked when I see people in the church on this feverish hunt for the will of God in a situation. And I'm like, well, what wise counsel have you sought? And they're like, well, I'm reading this book I found over at Barnes & Noble. It's called The 7 Habits of Wise People. And I'm on chapter 4 right now, and I'm really not seeing anything. I don't know. And I'm like, have you read the Bible? Has Jesus already spoken about the thing you're dealing with? Well, I don't know. Have you prayed about it? Yeah, I pray about it. Of course, everybody says they're praying about it, right? They can't say no to the preacher. And so I just wonder, and I'm just saying, if there's some lingering question that you're dealing with, God, what do you want from me in this situation? Be it your job, a relational struggle you're having, should I do this or should I do that? What if instead of just relying on what you've always known and making decisions and following the old script, what if for 40 days, I'm just throwing it out there because it's a good Bible number, you resolve to uncover everything that has already been revealed in the Word of God about the thing you're dealing with. And you prayed every day, God, tell me. And then you found 1, 2, 3 mature believers to give this situation to, and then, wait for it, listen to them. And see if what you hear in the Bible and what you hear in prayer and what you hear when you listen to those believers, they all match. When they all match, that's ding, 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 God has spoken. Has anybody experienced this before? I have. It's very powerful. And then when you march forward and you make the decision, you're not just like, well, I think maybe, yeah, I don't know. We'll see what happens. You're like, God has spoken, and here we go. And this is what I'm going to do, and I'm going to stay with it until God confirms that He talked to me. Are you with me, church? That's how you live, and that's what wisdom looks like. Number three, wise people are filled with the Holy Spirit. Paul has already told us that we have been sealed with the Holy Spirit in Ephesians 1. He commands us not to grieve the Holy Spirit in chapter 4. Now he is encouraging us to be filled with the Holy Spirit. Grammatically speaking, there are two overt commands in verse 18. Don't get drunk on wine and be filled with the Holy Spirit. Now, why would Paul link alcohol and the Holy Spirit? It's interesting, really interesting. Don't allow yourself to be influenced and dulled by alcohol. You know why. I want to ask for a show of hands to see who or who hasn't been drunk in the room. That would be shaming, and we don't do shame-based religion at Harpeth. But my guess is you know what happens. If you cross a line, you drink too much, then you start to do things you probably wouldn't do unless you had that amount of alcohol. And like you're just, the self-control has gone down, and the freedom to do crazy things has gone way up. And so you're living in your appetites and impulses. The word in the Bible in Ephesians 5, we glossed over it. It's debauchery. It's like a big, scary Bible word. And if you don't know what debauchery is, I would say Google it, but don't. If I Googled it, my internet accountability software would fire away and send messages to my partners, and it would not be good. So you know what debauchery is. I bet you do. So as opposed to that, indulging in alcohol and living under the influence or driving under the influence of alcohol, we live under the influence of the Holy Spirit, the third person of the Trinity, whom Paul has talked a lot about. He says in chapter 1, it's the same power that raised Jesus from the dead. Let him influence and infuse your entire life. And that's wisdom. That is wisdom. Let's look closer at the construction of verse 18. So some of you are like, oh, you heard the word construction, I want to tune out. I had a really good English professor in college, and I can feel his presence right now. And he would always say, when you get to a passage in the Bible or in other literature, and you know you've arrived at a big moment that's critical, slow down and chew on the words and ingest them into your system. So what I want to do is break down verse 18, and I want us to look at not just what is said, but the way it's said. The phrase I want us to look at is be filled with the Spirit. I want to talk about the mood, the form, the voice, and the tense. And I promise you, this has everything to do with your life. It's in the imperative mood. That means it's an authoritative command. It's not a passive suggestion. This is not good advice. This is do or die. Be filled with the Holy Spirit. This is obligatory, not optional. Can't be skipped over, necessary, essential. This has to happen. Trying to live the Christian life and trust and follow Jesus without a fresh, regular filling of the Holy Spirit is like trying to go on a road trip in a car that has no fuel in it. You're going nowhere. Without the Holy Spirit, the Christian life is a virtual impossibility. Let's look at the form. It's plural. Again, this is kind of hidden behind the words, but it's there. It's not addressed to individual Christians. This is to a Christian community, not to a few special people who are all hopped up on the Holy Spirit. So here's what it says. The fullness of the Holy Spirit is not a privilege for the elite Christians. It is available for everyday Christians like you and me. So the experience and the effects of being filled by the Holy Spirit should be normative, not the exception. We should pursue this. We should ask for this. We should put ourselves in a position to open ourselves up to the Holy Spirit, not just one time in a baptistry, but every day on our knees, in our house, on the way to work, coming home from work. That's a really good time to pray for a fresh filling of the Holy Spirit if you're like me and you're coming home to small children. Lord, help me to love my wife and my kids well. And my commute is only about 90 seconds if there's no traffic, so it has to be a powerful, a quick burst of prayer. But we serve a God who wants to give us this. He's not holding back. He's a good father. Jesus said when he was teaching his followers to pray, do you realize that, who among you dads, Speaking of Father's Day, how many of you dads, if your son asks you for a fish, would you give him a snake? I'm sure that got a laugh. We don't think of Jesus as a jokester, but that's a joke. Like, no, of course not. If he asks for a fish, I'm going to give him a fish. So he's like, that's how God is. And in Luke chapter 11, where Luke's version of the Lord's Prayer appears, go with me here, at the end, where he gives that analogy of which of you fathers would give your son a snake if he asked for a fish, then he says, how much more will our Heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to those who ask? If I had a mic, I'd drop it, but I won't. It's good text. It's a good promise. The voice is passive. Here's what that means, and here's why it matters. There is no technique or formula for working up the Holy Spirit. This is not hype. This is not emotion. The Holy Spirit affects our emotions, but it is not emotion. What is necessary for being filled with the Holy Spirit is a heart of surrender. That is all it takes. Whoever said that to have the Holy Spirit, you've got to walk through these five steps, pray these prayers, do this magical formula, that's superstition. It's not Christianity. The Holy Spirit enters a surrendered heart. Here's what that means practically. It means turning from what we know grieves the Holy Spirit and embracing what pleases the Lord Jesus. And doing it no matter the cost. And we have a God who responds to faith. What is faith? It's putting yourself out there. It's going for it. I don't know what that means for you right now. But we have a God who promises, if you draw near to me, I'll draw near to you. James 4:8 says that. Draw near to me, I'll draw near to you. There is no technique or formula. What is grieving the Holy Spirit in your life? Don't overthink it. Don't overanalyze it. Don't rationalize it. What do you know right now? This is not what God wants for me. It is so dangerous to our spiritual health to delay repentance, to put it off. The best time for turning from sin and turning toward Jesus is now. It is always now. We had some people in the first service do that. It kind of caught me off guard. I was walking around after the service, and independently, people were coming up, and it was the Holy Spirit's convicting power. And I don't know exactly what prompted it, but I'm just grateful that we're in a church where people confess struggle and sin. That's good. That's a good thing. We can't grow, and we can't enter into the deeper things of God if we're willing to stay stuck in Egypt. You got to go. You got to go. It's also written in the present tense. Each one of these, I'm realizing right now, could be its own sermon. So I'm having to like really bridle my thoughts here. It's present tense. That's big. It's massive. There are many different kinds of presence in Greek. This is present imperative, which means ongoing, continuous action. Which means that the filling of the Holy Spirit is not a one-time event. It is something that we can expect and pursue many, 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 many times. We can go on being filled by the Holy Spirit day by day. It's a privilege. It's a gift that must be renewed by faith and obedience, saying yes to the Spirit. Yes. Yes, God. Yes. Every time we open the Bible, it's like we're saying yes. Every time we pray, that's another yes. Every time we move towards somebody who's hurting and encourage them with a life-giving word that's yes to the Holy Spirit. It's giving the Holy Spirit something to work with. Every time we confess and like get honest about who we are and what we're really dealing with, that's yes, yes. And you know, after we do that, one of these yes things where we open ourselves up to the Spirit, often the Holy Spirit will give us a jolt of encouragement on the back end of that. Have y'all noticed that? After it's over, you don't regret it. It's like, wow, I didn't want to do that at the time, but then I look back and it's like, oh my goodness, why haven't I been doing that more often? That's God's way of saying, this is what you were meant for, and there's more where that came from. Come on, let's go. So if the Holy Spirit brings conviction to you, maybe he did earlier when I was talking about grieving the Holy Spirit. The convicting power of the Holy Spirit is not meant to threaten you or shut you down. It's meant to invite you to come forward and enter into the goodness and the joy of your Father. And let the kindness of God, which you are totally up to your eyeballs in, do you know that? The kindness of God is all over you and it's all over us. Let the kindness and the unmerited favor of God that you have right here, right now, let it lead you to repentance. And then you and Jesus embark on a journey together. See what happens and let him set you free. Present tense, right here, right now. Think of your relationship with Jesus like this. You can fill a balloon and make it float in one of two ways. Number one, you can fill a balloon up with your breath. And to keep it afloat, you have to run around chasing it and spank it upward. Like, pshw, pshw. We have to pop it up, smack it upward. And so my kids bring balloons home from this church a lot. Sometimes they're full of helium, and other times they're blown up by humans. And this is an interesting analogy. I heard a pastor named J.D. Greer talk about this, and it really resonated with me. Maybe it will you too. But performance-based, pull up your own bootstraps religion, it's like chasing a balloon around, and every time it's almost on the ground, it's like, don't do that. Start doing this. You're not doing enough. You got to pray more. You got to read your Bible. You got to do this. Look at her. She's doing more. She's better. You got to be like her. Look at him. He seems like he's going further in the Lord and whatever. And you're just running around, making sure this balloon doesn't touch the ground. And that makes you tired, frustrated. And every now and then, if we're honest, the balloon is going to hit. It's just going to. There's only so much energy and so much effort you have, and at some point, this thing's going to fall. And what do you do then? A lot of people approach the Christian life like that. They compare themselves to others. Like the old saying goes, they compare my highlight reel to your gag reel, especially with social media. This is what makes Facebook so toxic. Everybody's life looks so perfect. And so you run around trying to keep the balloon from falling. You get tired, frustrated, and defeated. The other way to make a balloon float is to fill it with helium. How much work does it require on your part to keep a helium-filled balloon in the air? It has a different substance on the inside. And it floats. The fruit of the Holy Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, gentleness, self-control. You cannot produce those fruits. But you can open yourself up to the Holy Spirit who can. Amen. And so, if you want to know what the Holy Spirit's agenda is for you, he wants you to become like Jesus. He wants to empower you to live as Jesus would if he had your life. If he had your struggles, your marriage, your children, your baggage, your hurts, habits, and hang-ups, and your wounds and your regrets. How would Jesus conduct himself if he had your neighbors? Good luck trying in your own power to be like Jesus in all those venues. Won't happen. The Holy Spirit must pervade every fiber of me to do that. And I don't want to be running around keeping this balloon from the ground. I want some helium. There is something harder than trusting and following Jesus. You know what it is? Not trusting and following Jesus. Trying to live as your own God. That's a burden I'm not willing to bear anymore. We were never meant to walk like that, to live like that. That life is no life at all. So what does it look like to live under the Spirit's influence? Let's land the plane now. The landing gear's down, but we're not quite on the ground yet, but we're getting there. Four marks of living under the influence in this passage, and we're going to go really fast. Number one, the Spirit affects our speech. Especially when Christians gather together, we should be careful how we talk to each other. Is there a hockey game tonight? Oh, okay. I'm from Alabama, and when I was growing up, hockey wasn't even a sport. So I know that's sacrilegious here. I know it's bad, but I'm just, don't judge me. Let me be honest. If you guys are getting together for like a Preds party tonight, think about the way you want to talk to people there. Somebody there might need a word of encouragement directly from you. If there are certain topics or certain people that make you want to gossip, don't go there. If you're tempted to laugh at something God despises and stands against, don't do it. When you go to your home group meetings this summer, if your home group is meeting, think about what you're going to say and how you're going to say it. You can't script everything, but you and the Holy Spirit can have a game plan. Oh, and this is where it's like the rubber meets the road. How do you plan on talking to your wife or your husband today? Speaker and author Sean T. Felden, who came here a few years ago, she's done this amazing research on relationships. She just wrote a book called The Kindness Challenge. I heard her interviewed on the radio a couple of weeks ago, where she resolved for several weeks to only speak words of kindness to her family and how it transformed her whole household. And then she wrote a book about all the research she did about kindness. It is breathtaking. The Holy Spirit shapes our speaking, not only what we say, but what we don't say. Number two, the Spirit inspires our worship. This is directly out of the text. Speaking to one another in psalms, hymns, songs from the Spirit, praising God. Oh man, I would love to really amplify this point, but I can't. There's not enough time. The countdown timer on the screen is like bearing down. All I'm going to say is this, all right? Here's the punchline to what I was going to say. If you want to have moving, transformative worship experiences here when we gather, the best way to ensure that that will happen is for you to cultivate a lifestyle of private worship to God between Sundays. Confession, one of the main reasons why, if I come here and I'm like, I really wasn't feeling it today. And I know I'm not supposed to say that. I work here. I'm a professional Christian. Sometimes I'm a part of the service. I really wasn't feeling it today. The song choice, I don't know. Like I don't know. I'd like a hymn sprinkled in every now and then. It's true. Hymns are like my native language with worship. Or you know, I wish, you know, the sound was turned up. I mean, you can get into that nasty, you know, me thing. Or the sermon. I don't. Maybe he wasn't as prepared. Whether it wasn't for me. the stories. It was long. And then I just get into this funk, and it's not good. Did you know there's a direct correlation between what I experience here with you and what Jesus and I do together between Sundays? I don't have any studies. I just have stories. I can tell you the quality of my worship experience here is in direct correlation to my private worship with God. You know, you can sing in private. You can. There's great power in getting in your car. Come thou fount of every blessing. Tune my heart to sing your praise. Streams of mercy never ceasing. Call for songs of loudest praise. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Not just here, in my cube where I work and return calls. In my bedroom, the Holy Spirit meets us in church buildings and noisy restaurants and in desperate places, in chemo rooms and in hospital rooms. The Holy Spirit meets us there. And whenever we ask, and whenever we worship, He meets us there. And if you do it privately, the public will take care of itself. You with me? All right, cool. Number three, the Spirit ignites our gratitude. I went off about gratitude last week. I'll spare you. And you don't need a speech about gratitude. I've got some statistics about the health and well-being of grateful people versus ungrateful people. The opposite of grateful is not ungrateful, it's complaining. Just, as one coach used to say, put that in your pipe and smoke it. Number four, the Spirit generates humility. Humility. How many of you, look at your Bible real quick, look at verse 21. How many of you have a Bible where verse 21 is not attached to the paragraph that begins in verse 15? It's its own paragraph with something about marriage. Raise your hand. Come on. More of you? Okay. A lot of you don't have your Bible open. It's okay. No shame. How many of you have a Bible where verse 21 is connected to the section that begins in verse 15 or so? All right. That's good. That's correct. It's interesting the way chapters and verses are all lined up, but verse 21 is actually an expansion of Paul's thought in verse 18 where he says, be filled with the Spirit. And one of the ways you know that's happening, one of the effects of the Holy Spirit, is it enables us to submit to one another out of reverence for Christ. And then he applies that thought logically to marriage in verse 22. But we're going to get there. I'm going to do my first sermon on marriage the week after Father's Day. I've never done a sermon on marriage. I didn't want to be the guy who'd been married for like 4 years and then tell everybody how to be married. That's annoying, isn't it? I didn't want to be that guy. So I've been married 16 years, been through some life, and it's the appointed text for the week after Father's Day, so I'd love for you to come and err on the side of grace with me, if you would. It's my first time to do it, but the Spirit's already been getting me ready for that. So I'd like to ask our communion servers to go ahead and distribute the elements for communion. Thank you all for hanging with me through this sermon. This sermon has been more like a shotgun than a rifle. You know what I'm saying? Some sermons are like one point, and it's right down the middle. Others are... you're spraying pellets everywhere. I don't know where the pellets are landing, but I would encourage you, let the pellets, the darts, the words of the Holy Spirit embed themselves. Don't deflect them. Let it in. And let something happen that is out of your need to be in control. And see what God does. I want to read an excerpt from Philippians chapter 2 to get us ready for communion. The word submit literally means to put under, submit. It means me putting myself underneath you, putting your needs above my wants. The supreme example of that in history is Jesus Christ. He did it. And that's what we get to celebrate now. Back to the balloon analogy. The main way we Christians receive a fresh filling of the Holy Spirit is by fixing our eyes on Jesus and turning our eyes from worthless things that distract and onto priceless things that redeem. Philippians 2 from the Message. If you've gotten anything at all out of following Jesus, if his love has made any difference in your life, if being in a community of the Spirit means anything to you, if you have a heart, if you care, then do me a favor. Agree with each other. Love each other. Be deep soul friends. Don't push your way to the front. Don't sweet talk your way to the top. Put yourself aside. Help others get ahead. Play second fiddle. Don't be obsessed with getting your own advantage. Forget about yourself. Think of yourselves the way Jesus thought of himself. He had equal status with God, but didn't think so much of himself that he had to cling to the advantages of that status no matter what. Not at all. When the time came, he set aside the privileges of deity and took on the status of a slave. He became a human being. And having become human, he stayed human. It was an incredibly humbling process. He never claimed special privileges. Instead, he lived a selfless, obedient life and then died a selfless, obedient death, and the worst possible death at that, a Roman crucifixion. Because of that obedience, God lifted him high and honored him far beyond anyone or anything, so that all created beings in heaven and on earth, even those long ago dead and buried, will bow and worship before Jesus and call out in praise that he truly is the master of all, to the glorious honor of God the Father. Lord Jesus, show us your goodness. You are the bread of life. Fill us up and satisfy our desires with good things. Let's eat the bread together. And Lord Jesus, you have paid the price. You've spilled your own blood. It cleanses us from unrighteousness. It sets us free from the power and the penalty of sin. And it puts us in good standing with God the Father. And it allows us to be filled with the same power that raised you from the dead. Help us to not just say it. Help us to believe these things and live from those realities. Lord Jesus, unveil your goodness to every person in this room. Draw everybody close. And as we drink this juice that stands for your blood, cleanse us. Stir our affections. Let's drink the cup together. We lift you up, Jesus. We love you. We honor you. We treasure you above all things. You are Lord. Amen.
We know where the Spirit of the Lord is.
Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty.
We know living in your freedom.
Living in your freedom, we see your glory.
We know where the Spirit of the Lord is.
Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty.
We know yours is the kingdom.
Yours is the kingdom.
We'll be right back. your freedom.
Praise God.